I just want to give you a quick recap of the case study that you're going to come back and do. Right? This is the Maxwell case study. Don't read it at the moment, I'll just give you what it is. Maxwell was the true James Bond of the corporate world, Robert Maxwell. He was an army officer in World War II, and he managed to convince MI6, the same organization that James Bond works for, to give him a loan to start a book translation company called Pergamon Press. That was the official reason. The actual reason was he wanted to get Russian scientist secrets, okay, across to the West. And MI6 financed him. After the war, he continued to run that operation. MI6 never asked for the money back. So Pergamon Press was there. Then he got into all sorts of odd dealings, and he went bankrupt in the 1950s and maybe early 60s. Okay. In fact, there was a report that he should not ever be a director again, but after some time you can come back as a director. He came back with force, formed Maxwell Communication Corporation, and he was the darling of the market in England. In fact, Credit Lyonnais and the Midlands Bank gave him £2.1 billion, not million, billion, in the 1980s for his business. For leverage buying. So everything seemed to be going well, and then suddenly one day he went out on a yacht and he fell overboard and died. Okay? About 2 days later they found a body. And then it was found out that he sort of fell overboard in the evening. But that day the first bank had put the plug on him to return loans, and it was found that he was heavily into debt. And that first bank put in the plug meant a domino effect of all the banks wanting the money back. So he died, and then the shares were suspended. There was some issues about fraud. Okay, his children were, he had two children also worked in the company, two boys. They were questioned and taken to jail. All of these sorts of things happened. So what we are going to look at is the companies and reports up to the point, the annual report before he died. And if a simple financial analysis enabled us to see the problem, then we don't have to wait until the man goes overboard and dies. Okay? Now why is he a true James Bond? Because the body was given a state funeral in Israel. He was a Jew. State funeral in Israel. Why would a businessman from England get a state funeral in Israel? It was because it was later found out that he was working for the Mossad. So MI6 and Mossad. Then when the Russian Empire disintegrated, the top of the KGB was questioned about Maxwell, and he said, yes, Robert Maxwell was working for us as well. So not a double agent, but a triple agent. MI6, Mossad and KGB. Okay, who knows, he might have been working for the CIA as well. Now, they never saw the body. At a Jewish funeral, you don't see the body. So there's a lot of story that Robert Maxwell never died, that the Mossad took him over, and that he's living with Elvis Presley and Marilyn Monroe somewhere, and maybe Michael Jackson. Okay, that there's lots of conspiracy theories, because it is quite a coincidence that he went overboard on the day that the bank put the plug. Okay, so that is the, go and look at Google and look at all the conspiracy theories about Maxwell. But the interesting thing is, could a CFA, chartered accountant, done a simple analysis of the accounts, done a few years scores, and found the company well before, the company in trouble well before he went overboard. So in your own group, I would recommend that two people work on the last year's tax result score. Other three people work on the financial ratios, again for the last year, the last 2 years. Okay. Ideally, we should be using Kefler, Altman, the four variable and the five variable. But we can't, because the case study is not one of my case studies. We don't have retained earnings as a separate item. They put it inside equity, so we can't really separate it out. So we can't use either one of Altman's scores, but doesn't matter, because Kefler is anyway a British based school, and Maxwell, the company, was British. Okay, so here's the income statement and the balance sheet. Now, one of the things that you may need to think about, and some of you might be wondering about it, is that in the balance sheet, there's long and medium loans. There's short-term loans, we understand that. But there's something here called non-current liabilities. So isn't the long and medium loan also non-current liabilities? Right? So what do you think that could be? Why are they separating it out from the loans to these other non-current liabilities? What is the possibility? Anyway, keep that in the back of your mind. I'm not going to take it as part of my long-term liabilities or my liabilities. I'm going to keep it separate, and later on I will tell you why. It's a very interesting part of the discussion. Okay, so is that score? You now know how to calculate it. You can see that the 0.2 is the concerning area. So it is sort of between 0.2 and 0.3. It's going down. So it is not an area of bankruptcy yet, but it is certainly the performance trend is worrying. So clearly a more detailed level of analysis is required. Okay, so the ratio analysis. What can we say about profitability? You can see that it is a reasonably profitable company. Well, these are the sorts of figures even in 2013 we'll be expecting. But please note about these 15 months. Why 15 months? This is not a subsidiary company that is aligning itself to the parent company. This is the parent company. So the moment you see a change in the financial year, you should ask as an auditor why, because there should be some very good reason for this. Okay, so this is a red flag as to the further investigation that auditor should be doing. So remember that the profit margin, the numerator, the denominator is both from the income statement. So it doesn't matter if it is 12 months or 15 months. It's okay to compare these, but this one you've got to be careful, because here the numerator is from the income statement and that's from the balance sheet. So this 15 months has 3 months extra profit in that. That's why it goes up to 15
months. Sir, is it because of the accounting period change?
Yeah, but my question is, why did they change? If you are a good auditor, you should ask, why did you change from December to March, right? If you are a subsidiary, you might say the parent, you are aligning us with the parent company. But if it's a parent company, there must be a good reason for doing it. So that is a red flag.
Maybe because of consolidation purpose.
Well, for consolidation, the subsidiaries can change. But why the parent company? So we'll talk about that, okay? Interesting, that's also part of the murder mystery. Okay. Current ratio, you can see profitability appears okay, but in terms of liquidity, now we are having problems. Anyone remember what the rule of thumb is for the current ratio? 2:1, and for the asset base of the quick asset ratio?
1:1.
So you can see that very, very good ratios over here. But now the current ratio with inventory is 1:1 and the quick assets has gone to 0.8. So it has only 80 pence of current assets to pay £1 of current liabilities. So it's in fair amount of trouble in terms of liquidity. In terms of solvency, it becomes even worse. Okay. So you can see that the solvency issue has become quite concerning. And if you look at the balance sheet here, you can see that the liquidation risk area of gearing is being achieved or reached. So your borrowings is now twice as much as equity. Okay, now please note that I have taken away that 305 from my calculation of borrowings. Okay, if you put that in, it will be a little worse, but I've taken it out. So anyways, twice as much borrowings as equity. which indicates that the profit before interest and tax, or the interest cover, you've only, after paying your debt, debt interest, you have only 70 pence remaining for everything else. Okay, now where did the problem arise? Once again, the big jump from 37% to 169% is in that 15-month period. So these are what was called leveraged buyouts. They were borrowing to buy, borrowing to buy. He went and bought all sorts of things like official airline guides and Macmillans, borrowing from the banks. And then there is the asset structure. Now when we looked at the balance sheet yesterday afternoon, we looked at the capital structure. That is, this side of the balance sheet. Now we are looking at the asset structure. So working assets to total capital, total assets would be an asset structure, but in this case, the big one is the intangible assets. So you are told that over half the assets of this organization is intangible, cannot be touched. Things like contracts, masters, like, you know, this would be a master, the Gulf News. Okay, those sorts of things are the intangible assets. So that would be an intangible asset. Okay, and book copyrights and all of those sorts of things, publishing rights. So the board of directors is claiming that these things do not have to be amortized because they have a life forever. Okay, so do you think that a Russian scientist's work that was translated 20 years ago still has a useful life in terms of amortization? Probably not. Okay, so what the directors are saying, that it need not be amortized. Okay, so you can now turn to this page if you haven't already done so. The profitability is consistently healthy and profitable, but liquidity is a problem, especially in terms of the current ratio. So if you look, right, current ratio is current assets upon current liabilities. But if your current assets have gone up because you haven't collected debtors, and your current liabilities have gone up because you haven't paid your creditors, then the ratio doesn't change, but you are in a bit of trouble. Okay, so sometimes it can disguise things. Okay, the growing creditors. So the debtors turn over by not collecting your money, they disguise the effect of growing creditors on the current asset ratios. Solvency. You can see the big problem started with the bank loans of Midland Bank and Credit Darnes to buy out these leverage buyouts of Macmillan and official airline guys. Now, you would expect, there are a couple of bankers here, that Midland Bank and Credit Darnes did their homework, did proper due diligence on the company before giving that loan. Okay, but as I told you, if you give a good enough story to the banker, they will accept it. What they want to know is that they won't get in trouble for giving you money. So these two, I mean, when you're talking about this sort of money, billions of pounds sterling in the 1980s, that's a hell of a lot of money. Okay, that was given to this company. Asset structure, as I told you, now it's about 2.1 billion. And according to MCC accounting policies for this class of asset, no amortization charge is made unless there is a permanent diminution in their value. In the opinion of the directors, these assets do not have a finite economic life. Subject to annual review, any permanent diminution in value is charged to the profit and loss account. But in this case, nothing was charged. Thus, the finances committed to the company relies heavily on a largely subjective view, the value of intangible assets, which are virtually assumed to have an infinite life. The sustainability of this position is questionable and will be closely examined in the next section. Okay, so let us look at that now. What we're going to do is, as I ask you all to do, we're going to try to look at profit before tax for the next period. Okay, to look at sustainability. We've already discussed the issue that other income is more than normal income. We've also considered the issue of the intangible assets. right? So we are going to look at all that. Okay, so this is the way you should analyze any company. Any company that you get, look at the exit score, look at the ratios, and then try to predict next year's income. Okay, that will cover a lot of the issues. So we're going to look at some of the subjectivity of the accounting methods chosen. Okay, so other income, as I told you, MCC earned more from other income than from operating profit. So let's look at that. And we've already said that of this, only 82 is sustainable, 110, especially the foreign exchange adjustments, not sustainable. Companies used to do this. They changed the method of translation, depending on if the exchange rate is going up or down, to get some benefit. But you can't do that change every year. What about the intangible assets? Well, usually, at that time, you had to amortize over 20 years, but except in exceptional circumstances. Right? But these people said no use of amortizing at all. But let us amortize, and the actual figure of 2.1 billion is about 2069 billion. And that amortized by 120 is about 103 million amortization charge.
So, Professor, what's the guideline to meet that line of amortization?
At the moment, the guideline is 20 years.
20 years.
At this time, the company, even now, the company can argue that their intangible assets have no finite life and you don't have to amortize. Mm-hmm. Even now. But it's stricter now. Okay, so the forecast, as I told you, give them the benefit of doubt. Okay, give them the same profit margin. Look at the 10% increase in sales, even though we know sales have been falling. Okay, so you saw that this is the figure. So I've advertised, I've taken the Pergamon Press post balance sheet item of selling that company. And the interest charge. Now, there was some discussion about the interest charge because after all, the money for this sale can go to redeem debt. What really happened was that money was used to pay your liabilities, current liabilities and so on, because there was much more concern about that. It was not used to reduce debt. In fact, Maxwell was the sort of person who, when he was in trouble, he went and bought more companies. He went and bought a company called the News of the World in the USA. So that's why the interest charge has been kept the same. Even if you were to reduce it, it wouldn't reduce that much. Because you're talking about now a change from a profit before tax of plus 145 to a profit before tax of minus 82. Now even if you do not do the intangible charge of 103, you're talking about a very, very small profit, about 24. Okay. So this company is in real trouble. And the question is, why did the City of London CFAs not tell the market or their clients who are shareholders in this company about the problem in the company? No one knew anything it appeared that no one knew anything until Maxwell went overboard. Okay, so the future, even with this reasonable, generous set of assumptions, the future for MCC would have looked weak even before the untimely death of Robert Maxwell. In addition, there is the problem of finding sufficient cash resources to repay loans totaling nearly 1.8 billion. The overwhelming majority of which are due for repayment within 5 years. The only solution seems to be to sell off profitable parts of the company. You can see that this is all already happening. The start of this process can be detected in the 1991 account with the post-balance sheet event disclosure, the sale of Pergamon Press to LCBA for 446 million. So even if the entire 446 million was used to repair debt, okay, you're talking about 446 million versus 1.8 billion. So there would be still 1.3 billion left of debt. Success are a sign of desperate, short-term measures aimed at survival. However, in the longer term, such solution can only cause further reductions in profit. The sale of Pergamum Press will remove annual profits of about 30 million per annum. Also remember that Pergamum Press was his baby, the one that he got MI6 money to start his company. When companies, despite the sentimental reasons and so on we've talked about before, any auditor should ask the question why the co-product of the company is being sold. But the auditors never ask this question.
Who bought?
Sorry?
Who buy it from them?
No, Pergamum Press. No. Pergamum Press was part of the company. They did not sell it the whole company. They sell it part of the company that
they sell it to someone.
Yeah.
And this is the most profitable part in this division.
One of the profitable parts, yes.
Question one, why he sell it and who buy it from
them? That's what you said the auditor should ask. Sorry, I was sentence. Yes. Why sell it and who bought it? Maybe he's after, you know. Okay, so that's a good question, yes. Okay, now let's look at calculating earnings per share. Okay, earnings per share. Remember when I talked about the price earnings ratio? We talked about price per share divided by earnings per share. Okay. So if you look at the accounts, the earnings are 99.2 and the number of shares is 649.200. Now, I heard some comments earlier. What can you say about that earnings per share? Now, please don't look at your notes, okay? You're going to spoil the story. What can you say about earnings per share? I heard some comments earlier on about something that is going to affect that figure.
Yeah, the extraordinary.
Okay, what can you say about it?
That the whole profit in 1991 is coming from extraordinary.
Not profit. No. In fact, it's a loss. Although there is no bracket, the earnings actually falls to profit for the year is half. So this number 49.5 actually is a negative number.
Yes, and he made the dividends of the whole earning.
Yeah, dividends will leave for, yeah. You're allowed to pay dividends more than earnings if you have retained earnings. You can pay out of reserves.
Yeah.
Right? So the thing is that the extraordinary items was post the earnings figure. Okay, it is a below the line item. So what has been happening by the financial accountants here and passed by the auditors? Okay, anything that is good and profitable has been put above the line as other income. Anything that is bad and non-profitable has been put below the line as extraordinary items. So very nice window dressing passed by the auditors.
But the extraordinary item is as per IFRS, it's classified after the net profit. It's not before, so you cannot add it to the operating profit.
Yeah. First of all, the accounting standards board in England. Remember that IFRS is really still negotiable between FASB and County Standards Board. We still don't know if they're finally going to give this to us. We're doing all this work and they've still not decided because FASB in America is against it.
Yeah.
Okay. However, the Accounting Standards Board in London says no more extraordinary. Okay, so there's no question about above or below. No more. Not allowed. Okay, but at the time that these accounts were put out, you were allowed that. So what they're doing is nice window dressing to make the earnings per share figure look good. Okay. Even the latest analyst should have been forward-thinking enough to recalculate the key ratio of earnings per share. So in the City of London, no one did this. In the MCC 1991 accounts, there's the exceptional income item above the line, so anything good above the line. and an extraordinary expenditure item disclosed below the line. So what exactly is this extraordinary item? Let's look at it. In the notes, you can read that the extraordinary item relates to disposal of printing assets and printing-related investments, which one would have hardly thought as truly extraordinary in a publishing and information services business. So it was ordinary items that they classified as extraordinary items and put it below the line. So that is why the result of this classification was to generate a respectable earnings per share of 15.3 pence, which have almost halved to 7.7 pence, the accounting distinction eliminated. The accounting standard board in England was proposing at that time to tighten up the definition of extraordinary items, which is now implemented, so as to virtually eliminate extraordinary items and hence to recalculate earnings per share after extraordinary, avoid any subjectivity in their proper classification. Now, the head of the accounting standards board is a person called David Tweedy. When I was at Monash University as head of school, they invited him across to our university, and we gave him an adjunct professorship for some time. He was David Tweedy at that time, now he's Sir David Tweedy. Very interesting guy. And he said, this is about the time Maxwell was happening, he said, if a Martian lands on Earth that is extraordinary, everything else is ordinary. Okay, so he virtually eliminated extraordinary items. Okay. So that's what has now happened. They've eliminated this distinction. No more extraordinary items. Unless a Martian lands on Earth. So in summary, much has been written about the ALE Maxwell Communications Corporation, particularly after the death of his entrepreneurial founder Robert Maxwell. His sudden decline was greater with great supplies in some quarters and with great anger in others with allegations of overly creative accounting. However, please look at this. However, a straightforward financial analysis would have shown a group that appeared to be reasonably profitable but actually hampered by excessive debt. MCC was able to do little more than service this debt. As a consequence, it was forced to sell large slices of its business in order to meet debt repayments. Further, there were some liberal, but not unreasonable or uncommon interpretations of conventional accounting practice at that time. So what they were showing, that window dressing, other income here, extraordinary items here, no amortization, all of that, was allowed at that time. These helped to create a favorable impression. However, there was sufficient disclosure to enable any analyst to make appropriate adjustments and read the figures in their true light. If anyone took the trouble to read the notes, they would have seen the true light of these figures. Okay, so the question is, did the banks know? They knew the problem. Maxwell is going round and round trying to get this loan and that loan, and banks are trying to reconstruct, restructure the loans and all of these sorts of things. And the day that the first bank put the plug, which means that every bank would have put the plug, was the day Maxwell supposedly drowned. Okay. What about the City of London? Maxwell rewarded him very nicely, lots of parties, lots of things on his yacht. And these people who were supposed to keep their clients' interests at heart kept quiet about the problems of this company. Okay, now let's look at that 305. What do you think that can be? Remember the 305 non-current liabilities? Sorry? What do you think? Loan? Not quite, no. Loan for the investors would normally be shown as equity, but you're talking about some sort of shareholders' loans.
There was a pension fund, wasn't there?
Sorry?
There was a pension fund in the
Bank of England, remember this. Yes, that was the pension fund, employees' pension fund. Okay, so it was not a loan from the shareholder, but a loan from the employees. Part of their money was kept aside for their pension. Okay. So now the company's pension fund is supposed to be The liability here that you have to give to the employees has to be represented by assets. In this figure here, which is your share certificates and so on, that you're going to take the dividends to pay the pensions. Right?
How could the pension fund jump from 62 to 366?
Well, the jump could be because they were, I don't know the full answer, but I'm just guessing that it could be because of certain leverage buyouts where you bring the other company into existence and so their pension fund is incorporated in your own pension fund. No, only this one was only the pension fund. That was only the pension fund. Okay? At this, I'm just thinking aloud, at this point in time also, Maxwell urged people to take the money from their other pension funds outside and bring it to the company's pension fund. Then he had lots of advertisements saying how good the company is and if it's worth investing in the company rather than in superannuation schemes outside. So could be all of that reason.
Maybe also the policy for this indemnity, the senior, becoming senior,
the
indemnity increased.
Well, the senior people who get a higher pension, yes. But the question was why the big jump? And then why the fall?
Can we change also the policy of this indemnity? Can we change from people quit the job?
People quit the job? And that's the second, the last one. But the question was, you know, doubling here and then doubling, not doubling, huge jump here.
So
it could be that picture. Yes.
I think if this is a liability, that means he took the money.
Yes, he got the money.
Right? You just said he was advertising that people can invest.
Yes.
So maybe this is a jump, that the people inject money in the
yes.
company, and then the fall after that from 90 to 91, this is a normal transaction. Maybe
that is not too great.
Okay.
The question
so
is
maybe
big
he collect the money from
the market. He advertised at that time. So if you had a pension fund with, say, now in Australia, you can keep your pension anywhere. I can keep my pension in the police fund, the doctor's fund, whatever. Whoever gives me a good thing, I can keep my funds. So he was saying to bring it over to his company funds. It is only after this case that they had lots of regulation on company funds, employee funds, pension funds after this. Before that, there was lots of companies could do this. So the basic point is that he must have assets to back up those money. So he has share certificates, but once again, the red light here, the 15 months was because later it was found out that Maxwell had actually raided the pension fund, taken the money from the pension fund by selling the share certificates and taking the money and using it for his leverage buyouts. He was hoping by delaying by 3 months, he can make his money, typical of these high risk guys. I can make my money, buy the share certificates again, put it there, and the auditors will never know that I took it out for a short while. Okay, but he could never make it good, and the auditors never checked. So this representation of this money here was never actually looked at. Okay, it's like people who have inventory, and when you open the container, there is nothing. I have done Unilever at one stage. Okay, and I was a very junior clerk there at one stage. We had to climb up these huge vats of coconut oil and so on. And so we put the dipstick in. It went nicely in there and we looked, oh yes, inventory is there. But we didn't realize that the top bit had a little hole there where you can put the dipstick in. And then there was a little oil and then the rest of it was nothing. Okay, Unilever might be because some workers in the night had done like that. Okay, so the auditors in this case never even looked at the share certificates. Okay, so now remember that you cannot sell share certificates just like that. You can't go, okay, someone has to do it for you. And the company that sold the share certificates was Goldman Sachs. Goldman Sachs sold share certificates clearly for that belonged to Maxwell and gave the money to the man Robert Maxwell. Maxwell Communication to Robert Maxwell. So what do you think happened to the man who was in charge of Goldman Sachs at the time of Maxwell, at the time of Enron and WorldCom, where again Goldman Sachs was implicated? What happened to that man, head of Goldman Sachs, who clearly should not have sold Maxwell shares and given the money to Robert Maxwell? What do you think happened to him? Is he in jail?
No. These people don't go to jail.
Huh?
This kind of people doesn't go to jail.
Yeah, they don't go to jail. But what happened to this guy?
Obama?
Huh? Obama? No, not Obama. Obama never worked for Mac, but you're close. Who?
He became a president.
Almost. His name is Henry Paulson. Does that name ring a bell? Henry Paulson is a tall guy, bald, who was George Bush's Treasury Secretary when the global financial crisis hit. He was the one who was given $700 billion to make a bailout. So he gave it not to Bear Stearns and Lehman Brothers that were his enemies. He gave it all to Goldman Sachs to save him. So that is Henry Paulson, former head of Goldman Sachs, was the Treasury Secretary. Okay? So this is a so-called non-corruption country like America, and they scold poor Bangladesh and Indonesia for corruption. This is corruption in a mega scale. Okay, mega scale. Okay, so now the problem was that his two sons had also signed the share certificate for sale along with the father. So the sons were implicated. The police visited them, and for a short while they were put in jail, and then of course they had very good lawyers, and they, the British system, legal system, which we all look up to, we all have followed the British legal system in some way, it tried to try these people. Now remember, millions had lost their money, employees had no pension fund, we are talking about real big problem. So the two boys, they're men really, their defense was, and I'm not joking, have a look at Google, their defense was, Daddy asked us to sign. We didn't know exactly, the company has so many subsidiaries and so on, Daddy pushed this in front of us, we signed, and the shares were sold, we didn't know anything about it. So are they in jail? No. The British legal have been corrupted right at the top. There were lords involved. Okay? They were out, they got out. Poor employees and the shareholders lost out. Okay, so their defense that Daddy told me, help. Okay, what do you think? Now let's look at Maxwell. That is Robert Maxwell. He and Rupert Murdoch hated each other. Right? So this is Rupert Murdoch's paper. Maxwell called Rupert Murdoch, who was also in the newspaper media business, a mock-eaten kangaroo at one stage. This is the Australian. When the decision of the auditors came up, okay, the only people who were fine were the auditors, and the auditors were Coopers and Lybrand, who is today PricewaterhouseCoopers. If Maxwell happened today, there would be no PricewaterhouseCoopers. Okay? Behind every disgraced tycoon is an incompetent auditor. Never looked at the share certificates, looked at all the creative accounting and approved it, no qualifications. Simon Jenkins asked why Cooper the Library stopped and did not receive harsher punishment for their role in Robert Maxwell's fraud. Okay. Something about $100,000 fine. Billions were lost. Here is the Times. Okay, when the case came out in 1999, no accounting for Maxwell. Again, the auditors. Okay. Talking about the pension fund and so on. Okay, so that was Maxwell, interesting case. Now, some years later, I was on a flight over Malaysia and I saw the Malaysian Sun newspaper and I had to smile to myself. Because the headline news in the Malaysia, in this Sun newspaper was, astrologer files ringgit 300 million suit and against who? PricewaterhouseCoopers. And why? Because PricewaterhouseCoopers had asked him to develop a financial forecasting software based on the movement of the planets. Okay, so a little bit better than palm history. Movement of the planets. Okay, if a company is going to do well or its liquidity and etc. based on the position of Mars and Jupiter and so on. So he has shown his model to Ramesh Chellaya, has shown his model, and Pricewaterhouse said he's not forecasting well enough and refused to pay him money. But the fact that they asked him to do it in the first place is amazing. Right? So if all else fails, if a liquidity ratio and the Z scores don't work, look at the planets. And you should be okay. Right? Anyway, now I'm going to show you what I promised I'll show you. Ideally, you should put your pens down, and maybe you should shut the camera off, but nowadays with the... No, it's okay, it's okay. Nowadays with the phones, people don't take notes, they just take a picture. Okay? So let me show you how legally, I'm not saying ethically, but just legally, following IFRS, you can make any profit you want and not pay any taxes. The best part of the CMA program. Okay. So this is how you do it. Now there's a recent Economist article that covers some of it. So here is Company A. Company A sells to Company B. Now Company B is a Delaware company. Now Delaware company, you get this in Florida as well, is a company where no one knows who the shareholders are. Only certain authorities in that state know. You can set up a company where the shareholders are Mickey Mouse and Elvis Presley, and no one, no tax authority, nothing knows who the actual shareholders are. Okay, so Company B is a Delaware company. Anyway, and of course you'd be clever enough never to have any of the shareholders of his in this company. So Company B provides a service to Company A, and for which Company A pays. Okay, so when Company A pays, it will be debit expense, credit cash. Let us say $10 million for that service. So Company B receives this money and it will say debit cash, credit revenue, $10 million. Now that revenue is taxable. Delaware companies are not in tax holiday. It's just an anonymous company you can set up. Okay. Right. Company B then is provided a service from Company C. Now Company C is in a tax haven. So Company B pays Company C, and the entry would be debit expense, credit cash for $10 million. So the revenue minus expense, now this entry is tax free. Okay, no tax impact. So Company C receives the money, debit cash, credit revenue, $10 million. But this revenue is not taxable because it is in a tax haven. Okay, so up to this point, now we have moved a lot of the money to a tax haven. Now, very, very many companies do this. This is simply transfer pricing into a tax haven or to pay tax, okay? But now here comes the beauty. Here comes the beauty. Company C invests in Company A in their shares, new shares, not existing shares, new shares. Okay? So the entry would be debit investment in the balance sheet, credit cash, $10 million. So now the cash that came out goes And now this company owns a part of that company. So the entry here is debit cash, credit, share capital. $10 million. Okay. So let us see the impact on company A. The impact on company A, when you cut everything out, is the cash and cash cancel out, and the entry would be debit expenses, credit, share capital. Have you ever seen, has your accounting professor taught you that entry? Your chartered accountant, the CPAs, don't know this entry, only CMAs know this entry. Okay. Now, isn't that a beautiful entry? Why? Because now you can deduct 10 million of expenses against your normal revenue from other sources. Plus, your company now is a bigger company by 10 million. Right? Then what happens? Then you send the money out again. Every time it ticks over, you have more expenses to deduct against normal income, and the company becomes bigger. And you become to such a size that you can take the company now to your banker and say, look at my company. It's a $200 million company. It's a big company. Give me some special loans. But it's the same $10 million of yours that has made this $200 million. Right? Now, where have I broken the law? Now, of course, no one is stupid enough to do it with exactly the same money with three companies. They will send this out to hundreds of companies in Delaware, Poland, and all sorts of places. Those will send it here, 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 here. Actually, the first one will not go to a Delaware company, go to some genuine company that will go here, here, finally come here, and not the same amounts, but the transaction is exactly like this. So what's good? Look at what's good. Because now this company is a big shareholder of that company, you have to consolidate. Right? So the consolidated revenue includes this revenue here. So your company is now very, very profitable from the IFRS consolidation. But you pay no taxes. You can't tell me that these are bad thing. You've got a company, massive size, you've got huge revenue so that the share market, you put the price of the shares up, and you don't pay taxes to the tax office at all. News Corporation has something like 147 subsidiaries in the Bahamas alone, and now they've moved to the US, but when they were in Australia, for the last 100 years, they paid no taxes. Here's what they did. Okay, this is what Google and Apple is doing now, and everyone is shouting, but you can't stop it because it's completely legal. Well, I'm not lying. I'm getting a genuine service. They are giving me a service. Tell me, where am I laundering? I'm not laundering. It's genuine money earned here, and it's going. Can anyone tell me where I'm laundering? And first of all, no one is traced, because you don't know which company, who owns this company. This company, you are showing the consolidation that it is, you are bringing the revenue, but no one will ever know that this revenue actually came from cash from yourself. Any questions? There are top CFOs over here and financial accountants. Have I done anything illegal? Now please note, and I want to tell you from the camera, I am not recommending this. I'm just telling you what companies are doing. This is what companies are doing. In the earlier classes, one or two people quietly come in Dubai and tell me, we are doing this in our company. Okay, so that is, as I promised, whatever profit you want, pay no taxes, and increase the size of the company.